I from?
I came from Adele. Tonight, we have Sandy Gaumont with us. Her mother, in 1982, was the president of the Foxboro Art Association. And Sandy's here. She's going to bring up a painting that her mother did. And she just wants to talk for about 5 minutes about her mom and some paintings that they're talking about exhibiting. So I'm going to let this turn over to you, Sandy. Okay?
Thank you.
Hi, everybody. You know, I haven't been in Foxboro for a number of years. I just had my class reunion said, you know, I want you to say what one it is, but everywhere I go, I hear people, oh, my mom took lessons from your mom, or my grandmother, or my sister, or somebody. So my mom is still well known around town. She passed away in 2012. And she had a lot of paintings. The family has taken what we wanted, my nieces and nephews, but I still have a lot of paintings that I'm paying storage on every month. And I feel that these paintings deserve a good home, and I know a lot of people would like a chance to get them. So this has been 2 years in the making. I had talked to Frank in the beginning when we were cleaning out my mom's house. And what we're gonna do is I'm going to have a show. The show is, after this show comes down, we're hanging that day, and it's going to be here through the month of November. It's being taken down on Sunday the 29th. The reception I'm going to have the second week, because November 2nd is a game, and I said it's not worth trying to get people to come to town when there's a game. So the idea is I would like to hopefully sell as much as I can on these paintings, and 20% of the proceeds is going to be for a scholarship for a Foxboro High School senior majoring in art. So we want to kind of get that word out also so that, you know, some people would really like to contribute that way. For those of you who were not familiar with my mom, as was said, she was the president of the Foxboro Art Association in the early 80s. She also taught out of her house both music and art. She taught piano. She taught Foxboro Adult Ed Art Education for close to 40 years. And she has exhibited in Ogunquit, Putnam, Connecticut, Attleboro Museum, Endicott Estate, Rockton Art Museum. She's in collections in Palm Springs, Largo, Florida, New York, Brahm and Dow showrooms in Boston. So she has a lot there. She was also on the Foxboro Art Council, which is a separate thing, and I understand, I think it was around the same time frame as the bicentennial. She did one of the, are the murals still upstairs? The painting mural, she did one of the paintings that the murals there in the wall during the bicentennial, the one of the town hall, and this is, in fact, I'm wearing a piece of jewelry. She was chosen, her design, she designed the Foxboro Bicentennial Medal. Which was done in 1978, and it had the Foxboro Company and the racetrack and the hat, the whole hat industry and everything. So that was kind of a fun, you know, we had the first day covers and everything. So she was very involved in the town. She lived here 57 years to her passing. So what I'm hoping is put the outreach to your people. You may know people who knew her, or you may know her yourself from being here. I know you have a lot of new members, but there's still some longtime members. She was of the generation when I grew up with Homer White, Bill Bureau, if those names mean anything in town. They were really the artists in town at that time. So I'm leaving a few of these cards in the back. There's going to be things in the paper. We want to get this out as much as possible, so please let your friends know, come and see the show, and hopefully it will be a good success, and and people, the paintings will go to good homes, and we'll be able to do a scholarship, and
that's great.
Be good.
So. Thanks. Thank you.
Tonight we're really happy to have Barbara Stone with us. She's a pastel painter. one of the founding members of the Pastel Painter Society of Cape Cod. I'm not going to take away her demo time, so I'm going to turn it over to Barbara, and you can give her your undivided attention. Thank you so much for coming, Barbara.
Oh, my pleasure. My pleasure. All right, well, I've done this before, and it's always the nerves before that drive you crazy. Once I get into it, I'm not so bad, but within that, I...
That's me, right? Okay. Wow, I wish this thing had a hook. Oh, it does have a hook. All right, good. Excellent. All right, so I don't know where I was. All right, well, anyways, I guess that when it comes time to prep for things like this, then I just end up to be a ball of nerves, so I don't really prep that much. And I was going to, of course, have the neatest box in the world because pastels are messy. And I didn't do that either because it would have added to the stress, so we're just going to go ahead and get started. I'm using sanded paper tonight. This is UART 500 paper. It does feel just like sandpaper. Some of the papers that I use don't really feel that way. Pastel matte is smooth. I'm going to tone this with pastel and alcohol, and I'm going to put on a big shape painting. One of the things that I am trying to get to, and again, I've been painting in pastels for over 20 years, but you know, it's an ever-evolving process, and I'm finding that I'm going back to my roots when I first started pastels. I sort of got a little bit finicky in the middle there, so now I'm trying to go back to bold shapes and bold colors. I brought these in. These are starts of mine. These are 100 stroke starts. And so, you know, I'm going to start, and they're going to look like this. And it depends how far I take them as to how far I want to. I would say these are probably about half finished. And but again, and you can see that I'm going for the big shape. So that's how I'm going to start. The cue that I'm going to give to you is that I'm going to take. There it is. Got it. I have my reference photo here, and I'm going to outline. I use this as a tool. Can you all see?
No. There we go.
Can you see?
Yeah. All right, there we go. All right, so I use a piece of acetate, and I'm going to outline my large shapes. And try to get it to be about maybe 5 shapes. Now, one of the things about this particular photo is that the bottom has the Phragmites, so it looks like a photograph. So I have to make that up, and I don't mind doing that. I actually sort of enjoy the process. So I like to encourage my students, too, to use a photo as a reference, but, you know, I've spent enough time around the marshes that I'm going to make it my own. And so I sort of like that I can't see what's really going on there, so I can't get too tight about it. So I'm going to break it down into five basic shapes, and then the game is on. Another trick that I use for getting the proportions right is that I'm going to take my photo reference, and if I had a straight edge, I'd draw it from corner to corner and continue across the page. So that then that would mean that my proportion of my photo was correct to the proportion of my paper. One of the things I see a lot too with my beginning students is that they might take a photo that's a vertical and then have a horizontal piece of paper and try to get it all in, and it just sort of doesn't match, you know, doesn't match up. So again, you can use the old proportion wheel, which is similar to a slide rule, but this technique works just as well. If my paper, I could take off this edge here, but I wanted a standard size. This is an 18 by 14 sheet of paper. So I encourage you to break it down into basic shapes. Another way to start is to mark it off and grid it. You can grid it into fourths, eighths, or however many, you know, tag marks you need to get to where you need to be to find your reference and your reference photo. All right, so from there, I might do a value sketch. I encourage everybody to do the work up front because it's usually makes for a better product in the end. All right. So I'm gonna hold on to my photo reference, and I have many. I can pass them around if anybody's interested. Also, if anybody has any questions during the process, I don't mind if you just shout out. So, Barbara, some people call me Babs. Either way is okay. I'm gonna start with a medium valued pastel. I did do a quick sketch of this before. All right, so this would be about as much of a sketch as I might get into. I don't really get into it too much, the sketching. All right. Okay, we'll start. All right, so I have an orange because I think the underlying color here is orange. I also like to have a warm, vibrant color for my underpainting. And I'll change it up as I go along. So I'm gonna go over here. This is a hard pastel. This is a new pastel. There are many brands. I'm up on a bluff here looking down on, so I can see some water in the background, which I would not be normally able to see. I also want my center of interest, which I think is this dark space of the marsh inlet here, to be one of my focal points. And I try to put my focal point within sort of the third somewhere. I think I'm going to move it down, actually.
Why is that so important, the third
concept? It's like it's the theory of having a good balance. I wouldn't want my focal, my center of interest in the middle of my paper. It's just considered poor composition technique. So if you put it where some of these third lines meet, something about the balance of the paper, the painting, that helps it along. Also, this is a center of interest because it is my darkest dark and then my lightest, one of my lighter lights of the marsh is next there, so it also brings the eye right there. So I'm gonna do that. Okay. I'm gonna put this orange back in here. I'm gonna put my darks on next. All right, I'm going to choose, pastels have changed dramatically in the last 20 years. We're in the beginning, there were just a couple of brands, and we really didn't have a big selection for darks. But now with the new, Terry Ludwig has a line of pastels. He's out of Colorado. I don't use black, I don't use too much brown. But now we can get some nice, rich, dark colors that really look like they're nice and rich. They really work well. I don't know why I don't use brown. I just don't sort of like it. And the black makes everything dead. So I have a really dark purple here. And then I like to put some dark along the bottom of my painting too, because I think it gives an automatic amount of depth. It gives you, if you have not your darkest dark necessarily, but a dark along the bottom does allow you to, you know, get that depth of the feeling that people can walk out onto. And that's my mission, is to get it to look like, even though it is a flat surface, that it is three-dimensional. All right, I'm going to add some more color just to beef it up a little bit.
So was that purple and Terry Ludwig?
The purple was Terry Ludwig. Or, and also, Schminke is another soft brand that I use, but I do have more Ludwigs than I have anything else.
Do you like Sennelier at all?
I like Sennelier. They're very crumbly. You know, I have pretty much any all of them at some stage of the game. I like that you can buy a Sennelier by the stick at Blick in Boston, so you can actually go and look and touch and feel. Because, you know, when you, I guess it's the same in Foxboro. There's really no place to get art supplies so much that you can't, I mean, for pastels, excuse me. I know you can go get oils most places. But, you know, the houses, the art houses, the line of pastels that A.C. Moore and Michaels carry are really poor quality. They're for kids. I mean, they're fine for kids, but they're not meant to be layered. And one of the things about pastels is the layering. I picked up this pink. I do this a lot. I don't really know why. I wish I did. But then, you know, but I can justify it by saying, well, you know, there is that glass wart. Glass wart is out at this time of year. And it is magenta. Another name for it is pickle grass. And on the marshes, you do see this magenta. It is magenta. It is a little darker than that, but it's just about that color. I'm going to add a note for my sky. I used to put the skies in first all the time, and I just recently stopped doing it. I don't know why. I don't. And I think that, you know, it's okay, things can change, and I think that's a good thing that we allow ourselves to change and not get, you know, so deeply rutted in our ways that we're comfortable with and all that. So I need a light value for my sky, so there it is. Okay. All right. So the fun begins. These are my photos. You can pass them along if you don't mind. All right, so I'm going to use rubbing alcohol. I hope I have a brush. Oh, I do. Good. Okay. All right, so I'm going to start with the light colors so that my alcohol doesn't get dirty. Too dirty, too fast. It's already dirty because the brush was dirty, but within my preparation, there we go. So I am just going to wet this. And so I'm painting it. It is pastel, and it looks like paint. And I can leave this showing, or, you know, but I will cover over a lot of it. But I'll leave some of it showing through, I hope.
How long to dry?
Just a few minutes, five. I do this so that I have a color on my paper, and also the alcohol knocks down the tooth a little bit of the sanded paper.
Does it eat the paper?
Say it again?
Does it deteriorate the paper at all?
No, it doesn't. It will if I, it does on some papers. Not all pastel papers can be wet. They feel, some of them feel sanded, like La Carte, I think, is one that feels sanded. And you think, oh, great, you know, I'm going to wet this and paint on it or take something off. And then it's made out of some vegetable product, and it just takes the sanded surface right off. But the UART Wallace paper was the originator of the sanded, and there are many brands. Art Spectrum is a brand of sanded. It also comes in colored, it comes in colors. Some people do that. Pastel matte, you can wet, and that comes in colors too. I like to do this. I sort of like it. I like the colors that I can get on it.
Where's this marsh?
This marsh is in Sandwich.
Okay. Is it along the stretch of 6A?
It's on a stretch of 6A, but this particular view is near the Spring Hill area, which is, it's north of 6A. It's not Scorton, but it's the marsh next to Scorton. I think it might be called the Great Marsh. I'm not really sure.
It's a beautiful picture.
Now, from here, I can't tell, but if any of your mixture runs,
yeah.
will that show up later on?
It might, if I want it to, it will. But I can cover over it. I can cover over it. It's horrifying, isn't it? So I bet you're all dying for this raffle tonight.
Right? The mobile doobobbers, maybe at 8, will stop a little bit.
Yeah.
To do the raffle.
Yeah.
And, you know, and people get to move next to them and continue after about 10 minutes.
Sure, that's good. Okay. And then I'm going to back up on it because I can't see what I'm doing.
Good.
So I need to, oh, man. I had a lot of work to do.
Yeah.
All right. All right, it just takes a couple of minutes to dry and set.
How do you like the gloss derizo?
So the Rosalie Doe is a pastel artist who lives in Orleans on the Cape, and she and her family have a business. It's called Take It Easel, and it really is great for being out on a windy day, and because you still might have to anchor it down, but you know it has the legs that dig into the ground, and then but on very windy days I would put some kind of an anchor on it, you know, whether it's a bucket of sand and a bungee cord or something. A lot of people put their pastels right here on the this little place here, this bridge here, which really works out great, but I just don't trust myself, and I don't want to be picking up pastels on the rug tonight, so I'm going to leave them over here. So, all right. Pastels are one of those things, as many pastels as I have, you never have the right one. And but we'll give it a go. I did a painting a little while ago that had a buttery sky, so I was thinking about doing that. And of course, on the way up, then I was looking at the sky and deciding, all right, what color am I going to put the sky? What am I going to do?
See the moon?
I really don't know. So this is a buttery sort of color for now. And again, when I want the marsh in the back to recede, so I'm going to put some of this light back there too. It might be a little bit too light, but.
So what pastel is that?
This is what brand?
Color.
What color? This color. I think it's the color of the walls that are in here. Pretty much. All right, a lot of times, too, when I hit my box, I might take 3 shades of the same color, or try to. I sort of missed on that one, but. These are greens. They're soft greens. They're cool greens to a certain extent. Because again, I want whatever is in the back here, I want it to be pushed back. I want it to stay back there. I want it to pop forward. So, it'd be probably good if I took a look at the photo about now.
Do you have any left?
And Yeah, so I just tried to get a bunch of scribbles sort of together to finally look like something that looks familiar. These need to be thinner back here, and I'm making them pretty thick. Because again, my lines in the foreground will be wider and bolder, and my lines in the back to make this go back will be narrower and ultimately lighter in value and temperature, cooler in temperature. There's something about having your back to an audience, I'm just saying. Okay. All right, I'm going to try to get some water, some of the water pieces in here. Water I usually try to put on with horizontal strokes to make it lie down. Looking for a cool orangey color. So this is what I got going. I try to put a little bit of a color that I pick up everywhere. I sometimes liken my pastel paintings to tapestries. So I sometimes envision that I've got my stack of threads all down here that I'm pulling up throughout my painting so that I keep my palette consistent. And then, you know, I know it looks like I'm using a lot of crazy color, but it'll even out. It'll like it sort of pops through, and I'll probably go over it a bunch too. Between this paper is very forgiving. You can put up to about a dozen layers of pastel on it, and it changes the one on top of the other change slightly. So it makes it a little bit more interesting. Because there are a lot of colors in the marsh. There's a lavender, the sea lavender out there is pretty purpley. I'm trying to get warmer as I come closer so that it will read the right way. I do have a box of neutral greens here. All right, this color, I'm not sure if it's blue or green. I guess it's green. Looks gray. So again, I want to push this stand of trees back a little bit. I've got some warms in there, but I want to push it back a little bit. It's awful hot back here, so I'm gonna go after that too. I'm going to make note of where the sun is hitting the trees.
always mount the paper on a black foam board?
No, not always. I'll use white. I think that what they say is that if your paintings end up to be dark, then you should use a light board. And if your paintings have to be too light, use a dark board. But I really just buy what I find in the stores at the day that I'm looking, and sometimes they're black and sometimes they're white. And I just sort of go with it, you know. I'm just sort of, a lot of my art is serendipitous in nature, where it's sort of, I have all of this experience behind me. I've done my share of coursework. I have been to the Rhode Island School of Design, not as an undergraduate student, but as a continuing ed student. And so I've pretty much had art as a hobby for most of my life, especially since my adult life. So I've taken just about everything and tried just about everything. So I think it all sort of comes together. I hope it comes together at a certain time. And so it's a series of educated guesses, I guess, is the way I look at it. It's like I have the knowledge, I have the experience, then it's up to me to put it together. But I sort of like the way it accidentally sort of comes together at certain times. And so hopefully tonight is one of those nights, I guess. I'm going to get that dark in there and then leave it, this little space in here. Ah, that's a good color.
Can you ever have too many pastels?
No. I know. That'd be a no. Nope. I don't. Oh, well, unless you have so many that you can't find them sometimes. So, you know, that ends up to happen sometimes, because I have, you know, I have more pastels than this, and they're at home. And you just can only carry so many, and you can only put up with so many at a time. All right. I have a very light green now. Oh, it almost looks yellow.
Do you like the UART better than the Kitty Wallace paper?
Well, the Kitty Wallace paper I used to love, the museum grade paper, but it has been unavailable for so long, I don't even look for it anymore. You know, the big houses, they never have it, and I don't think Dakota has it either. Dakota is strictly a pastel supply house out in Washington State, I think. And so they have everything pastel. And the Wallace paper, I bet it's been 10 years since they've really had a consistent production. And but originally, that was my favorite. I once splurged on a roll of Museum Wallace that I just coveted for a long time. And but I don't, like I said, I don't even look for it anymore. You know, it's just not available. All right.
So you would prefer that
over this? Well, the UART I like. I just started with pastel matte, and I bought it in the buttercream color, and I did a beautiful piece in that. And that was fun. Mm-hmm. And I thought about using that tonight, but then I just thought, well, this is really what I do, is the underpainting. And this is what I've been doing for a long time, since the sanded paper came out. I started with pastels in 94, and the sanded paper probably came out about 97, and so it was maybe 96. So as soon as Lorraine Trenholm was an artist that I used to take lessons with back in the beginning, and she's a very bold girl, and she uses color like nobody else that I know. And so I took a workshop with her, and it opened a new world with the underpainting, the sanded paper, the alcohol wash. I've experimented with gold leaf on this as well, which works okay. You have to plan ahead, and then maybe sometimes you don't, because you have gold in there and it sparkles when you look at it at certain angles. But I really liked the idea of that for a long time, and I really explored that too. I used to paint with gold underpainting, shiny gold, but I got over it. And I just did one this past summer with the gold leaf, because I had a little bit of vintage gold leaf left from the late 90s. So it was funny how it worked out, but I was glad when it was gone, because it's very difficult to work with gold leaf. If anybody's ever worked with gold leaf, it's crazy hard.
Go right over it once a time?
Well, yeah, you try, you do, but then it's almost like it's gold leaf, you know. You just don't. Yeah. So. All right, this is sort of crazy, but that's all right. All right, so I'm gonna, it's pretty light in here, so I'm gonna put a lot of this on. Pretty light layers though. So I'm not filling my tooth at all. And that's another thing I think that beginners really get sort of caught up with is filling the tooth too quickly. And then if you go over with the wrong colors, then you get that mud, you know, how that is. And then at the end, I just sort of make these crazy marks and hope for the best. All right, and I'm gonna take a look. All right, so it's very yellow, though. So I'm gonna.
What's wrong with that?
Well, I don't know what's wrong with that, but it seems like something. It seems like something is. So I'm gonna get some purple, and I'm gonna punch a little bit. And, well, that's the nice thing about pastels, because, you know, these colors are just beautiful. So we might as well use them, right?
Usually paint on location?
I want to say yes, but no. it's a lot of work. I like to paint on location when I'm in the mood, when the weather is perfect, when the sun is exactly perfect, when I have enough time to do whatever I feel like and there's nobody watching and there aren't any cars going by. So it doesn't happen very often.
You could have done that up in Maine, Barbara.
Huh?
You could have done that up in Maine.
No. I tried to get on small paint.
That's the same criteria.
Yeah, right. And if I take a workshop that's plein air and I'm forced to, okay, I'll do it then too. Okay. All right, so one of the things that I find, you know, I put all these wild colors on underneath, and then I get very safe. I get a little bit, and then I put the local color on, so the colors that it is, I put those on. But then I'm finding now that I like to go in and push the color back a little bit, push it with the, just to make us know that it's pastel. So I like the brilliant colors. I like the strokes to show. I want to make this a fall-ish thing, but I'm going to put the orange or the red on at the very last because a little bit of orange goes a long way and a little bit of red goes even further. So I find that like I might even have enough of the red tones in here if I can let these underpainting areas show through a little bit. That might be enough, and the yellow grass might be enough to let us know that this is a fall marsh scene. And because there's nothing like killing a painting with that orange and the red. It just is a really just tough thing in the landscapes. That's what I find anyway. So I'm going to stay away from the reds and the orange. If I can at the end, I'll add it. But I don't think so. I mean, who knows? I don't know what's going to happen. So I'm going to go in, I'm going to add some blue in my sky, some kind of blue. And I'm here.
Put that yellow with the alcohol?
Yeah, everything was washed down with the alcohol, so it won't bleed in and make it green.
That's my question.
It's dry, and if I had just the yellow on there, I'd have a green sky about now, but I don't really. This is a very light turquoise over the yellow. And I'm gonna let it be for a little bit right now. I might go back in again. I gotta go back. All right, so I still think I can get lighter in the back so that I can push that back a little bit. So let's see what we have. That's a mistake. maybe I'll leave it to see what happens. All right, so what comment? You know, it's push. I feel like that's pushback now with that shade that's back there. See what happens here. This in here is pretty pink.
Did you want to take a little break and go for
10
minutes?
Is it time?
Yeah.
I'm good.
Okay.
All right, good. I just have a glass of water. All right, so I don't have too much left to go. I want to bring some things together. I got to look at my photo reference. And so there's a lot of green back in here too, so I'm going to add some details about now.
Oh,
If I want a fine line, I can break, give my pastels a fresh break, and I can get my fine line with that. I'm not ready for that yet. There's a V in here somewhere that I wanted to get. Here it is. Okay. All right, and then I'm going to punch that. Oh, I got to push that green back. Okay. All right, so when I start talking to myself, that means that things aren't going great. And I could also have been known to stomp a little bit and swear. So keep that in mind.
Just strictly pastel.
You know, I've been playing around with, I started with watercolor way back when I was 30 or so. And then I've recently been playing with water-based oils. I did oils in the middle there somewhere. Mostly it was still life and stuff like that. And I learned the basics of it. And recently I've been working with water-based oil. And I don't know if it's me or them, but I find them really sticky. Anybody else water-based oils? They're really sticky, and the brushes get in the way, I think. I'm just not used to using the brushes, and then I get frustrated. It's almost like I just want to finger paint half the time. So I'm trying, because they sell better than pastels, for sure.
Is
cheaper to frame. The one thing about the biggest drawback about pastels is the price of the glass. It's not even the molding, because I am represented by a gallery in New Orleans. It's called Gallery 31 Cape Cod. The website's Gallery 31 Cape Cod. I also have a website of my own as barbarastonepastels.com. But the glass is about, for a painting this size, the glass is about $100 for a piece of glass, 80 to 100. It's museum quality glass that's not very reflective. So you really, it looks like it doesn't have glass on it until you get up close. So it's worth it because, you know, the older pieces that I have in my house that have the reflective glass on it, you know, you just end up going like this a little bit to try to get through it all. So, you know, I do put the money out on the moldings and the museum glass. I think it makes a big difference. And then, but it does get to the point, well, now I've started to frame them a little bit more of my own, so on my own. So I lately have been putting the glass directly on the pastel and then getting the acid-free tape and taping all the edges together with just a little lip. And then putting it into no matte, because traditionally pastels were matted because paper paintings or paper like watercolor was paper and it was matted. But not about maybe 10 years ago or so, some people just started to frame them without the mats. And, you know, because they are paintings and they are color fast. One of the reasons why they got a bad rap was because the paper, the Canson Mitant paper, which was the original pastel paper, comes in beautiful colors, but the colors of the paper are not light fast. And so the colors of the pastel might have stayed the same, but the paper didn't stay the same. So the Degas paintings that are on that paper, that's one of the issues with pastels in general. It isn't the pastel, because the pastel is pigment and binder. It is a pure product, but because it doesn't have, like, even oil paint has linseed oil or some kind of oil in it as a binder. And pastels is pretty much rubbing alcohol and pigment. And but they found that the paper, it was the paper that wasn't light fast. Mm-hmm. So that was the problem with that. All right, I'm gonna push this back. I'm gonna get some light blue and try to push my try to glaze over my back here and push this back. See how this one's popping forward now? Mm. I don't want it to do that. So, and I tend to get very horizontal in my strokes. I like to go with it, but sometimes it works against me. All right, so the mystery is down here and here, and I sort of, and also I have this, this is my favorite shape, right here. See this shape right here? And see how I've repeated it right here? Mm-hmm. And I've almost repeated it right here. So I have to change it, I have to get rid of it. It's one of the things that I fight. I'm just naturally really symmetrical and balanced. So I take the good of that, and then, but I can at least now recognize it in my paintings so that I get frequently get that shape thing going. And you know, it's always the same size. I suppose I shouldn't be pointing out my flaws, should I? But you know, it is just one of those things that I'm looking at it now, and it's like, you know, I always do that. Why do I always do that? But I'm going to fix it. I'm going to fix it. All right.
Barbara, when you lay your glass down on top of the painting directly,
yeah.
Explain how you do this on the top. You're putting what kind of tape in your lid?
Well, artist tape. That white artist tape is fine. You know, you just have to make sure that you only get a little lip. You just, you know, you just have to catch the lip, and then it can go back underneath.
And then you're going underneath the
you
painting?
You go four sides, you go, well, yeah, and there's a board on the back of the painting.
Yeah.
There's some kind of, you know, foam core or something like that on the back. So, yeah, so it's the glass on the top, the painting, and then a piece of foam core. And then you tape the sides all the way around, and then you drop it into the molding.
Do you and then fixative on that before you put the glass on?
Fixative? I don't use fixative at all. No. It might take a couple of passes with the glass on top, and then you get the little speckles of pastel sometimes, and then you have to take it off and clean the glass and put it back on. That usually happens a couple of times, because at some point in time the pastel is going to be thicker, or the strokes are I'm going to leave, you know, depending on how hard I apply the pastel, it's going to leave some kind of speckle, so that if I put anything on top of it, it's going to smush a little bit. I could, you know, spray it with some air, you know, in a can to get rid of some of the extra. But I just find, you know, if you put the glass on enough and take it off enough, it ends up to be okay. And half of the time I don't do it. I ask a friend to do it. So there is that as well. But it does save me money on the frame costs. So then I just pay, you know, the framer that I'm dealing with now, materials plus 20%, and then that takes care of that.
Why don't you use a fixative?
I don't need to. I find that it changes the color of the painting, so I've worked really hard to get, you know, my composition on, and I've got all this beautiful pastel, and its luminosity and everything, and I think that the fixative changes it. It definitely darkens it and changes the color. And but with the sanded paper, it doesn't come off. It doesn't. It won't drop off. Even when I've had used to put mats on my paintings, I really don't have any trouble with dust at all on the, you know, and I bounce them around pretty good. But it just doesn't come off the sanded paper. And I haven't framed so many of the Canson ones that I know what happens to those. So I have a couple that are out there somewhere, but I really have to resolve this issue down here. Right? All right, so what I'm trying to do is get rid of that big shape. And this goes right across the middle of the painting. Why did I do that? Let me look. All right. All right, so I'm going to just break this up with strokes. Now, I've got to do something here, but the decoration part, I just sort of go with my own calligraphy of sorts. And, you know, it sort of makes it mine. You know, I just, my marks are my own.
You paint outside?
When I have to.
So you mostly paint from photos?
I mostly paint from photographs, yeah. But I have painted the scene. I do think, and I go there, and I stand there, and I look at it. It's different, you know, because if I just had a photograph of a place I didn't know, I don't think that I would be able to accomplish it. Because I see that again with my students a lot, where they're using a photo of mine or a photo from a magazine. They don't know really what's around the corner or what's there. And then it reads that they're not so sure of what it is. And this, and again, you know, I've been living in Sandwich for 25 years now, and I live down the street from Scort Marsh, and this looks like Scort Marsh, but it just happens to not be Scort Marsh, which is just a huge big marsh that stretches all along from Sandwich down into Barnstable Village, actually, all the way into Barnstable Village. So most of that inner side, Sandy Neck Beach and all of that, the marsh is on both sides of 6A down in that area. So I, you know, within my driving, and I teach in a school that's on 6A as well, so, you know, my little drive to work every morning is, just checking out the colors and all the seasons and all the rest. So.
Did you say you thought it was Great Marsh?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is it Great Marsh?
Is that what you said?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Great Marsh, yeah. Yeah. So that'll be the name of the painting. We'll call this painting Great Marsh. Hope for the best. Okay. All right. All right, I need something to go on over here. I need to... Get rid of a little bit of this purple. Oh, I forgot about that area right there. All right. I'm going to go pretty warm up here. I can do an advertisement for the Pastel Painters of Cape Cod. We're having a workshop of our own on October 18th by Shelley Eager, who is lives in Franklin, I think. And she's doing a workshop on, the antiques and ceramics and pottery and things like that. She had a beautiful piece in the Four Pastels Only show, which is our national show that we have in the Cape Cod Cultural Center every June, July. And the workshops, they're one-day workshops, they're $60, but you have to be a member. So we have but then we go through the winter with the workshops. So we're going to have, after Shelley, Michael Evans of Attleboro is going to be doing an abstract pastel landscape with with acrylic paintings, acrylic base, and then pastel. And then I plan the workshops. That's why I know this. I have Ed Chesnovich, who is a wonderful, colorful painter. A lot of marshes, big, beautiful skies. He's doing one on dramatic skies in February. Christine Ivers from Connecticut is coming in March. Jean Hirons, who has a book all about pastel that she's published. This is a wonderful book. She's from Maryland, and she's coming up in April. And May is Michelle Mazzone, who just won last year's Best in Show at the Four Pastels Only Show. She's a wonderful painter. So we've got a nice lineup coming up. And then our international workshop person this year is Tony Elaine, who's from New Zealand, I think, and he's coming in June. So the monthly workshops, the one day is a 60, and you have to be a member. And then again, for Tony Elaine, it'll be open to members only first. So if anybody's interested in that, then that might be a thing to join in the winter. Yeah, I also have to credit the Pastel Painters Society of Cape Cod because of the ongoing workshops. I did pick up a lot of crafts and arts and all different mediums and put them down again. But with the Pastel Society, I think having a group is really crucial to our own art development and our lives as artists. And so it is a credit to those who manage and help have events like this. So. Again, thank you. Thank you for having me. Okay. I have some teal. This is another one of those, I don't really know why. I think I need something else going on in here. And again, with that whole tapestry thing. Fix the water. I'm still half and half. All right, so I want to try to find something to balance this. So I'm going to bring some dark in here because it's just sticking there in the middle of nowhere. I think it just needs to be played up. It needs to be balanced off somehow. And again, I sort of lost this angle up here. All right. Okay. All right, so then I put the dark in, and now I got to take it out. So, temper it. You know, I mean, it's just now that I got the lines in, but. See, I'm so horizontal with this. I do want to break this up a bit because there is this beautiful piece of triangle that's going across here, and I missed it. And then I can lighten that up a little bit too while I'm in there. See, I still have those balance pieces. Everything is so neat. All right, so I'm going to highlight that. I don't like that color. So now I'm back to my original color, the one I started with. And hopefully we'll be able to get everybody set up here. I'm almost there. All right. So what time is it now, everybody?
We have about
10 minutes. 10
minutes?
Okay. I'm just going to heat things up a little bit, and then I think I'm going to call it a day. Oh. This is wild.
Looks pretty good from back here.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, step way back.
The green. I just to cover it a little bit more. And then this is just a little bit too much.
It's like she's wiping out a little. She's blood.
I'm just it's adding green. Green.
Yeah, there's more solid shapes.
All right. Mm-hmm. I'm done. Yeah. The orange, yeah. Yeah? Oh, great, yeah, really?
Is that right in the corner?
Yeah.
I kept going, amazing, I've never seen.
Oh, okay.
And you were doing this.
Yeah. Oh, good. Yeah, good. Yeah, I got it, yeah, I got it.
Can you see?
I did, when I put, as soon as I put that in, I was like, oh, yeah, okay, that was a good.
I'm holding my breath.
Yeah, good. I put the green, that last green.
Well, it's absolutely.
No, thank you. Ah, good, good. Oh, excellent. Oh, good.